Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Oh my God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name.
Through
touch the sky. May we see clearly. May we have the capacity to listen. Amen. Please be seated. Good morning, good shepherds.
Good morning.
Yes, I'm back. I hope you are well this morning. I have to say, just reading that gospel now, when the disciples ask Jesus if he wants them to zap these people for not welcoming him, I watched part of that Doctor Strange multi-universe last night, and I had this image of the disciples going, it's all true. Last Sunday, when we recognized Juneteenth and emancipation during the Civil War, I thought we had already dealt with freedom and slavery. And then we get the readings for today. In Paul's letter to the Galatians, we heard, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Not only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another by loving your neighbor as yourself." And he continues, "Live by the Spirit, not the works of the flesh. Let us be guided by the Spirit." When I got to that line, being guided by the Spirit, I had a flashback to about 1956 or so. My mother, sister, and I lived in an apartment building in Washington, D.C. My grandmother also lived in the building and was the manager there. Often when school was out, my sister and I would stay with my grandmother until her mother got home from work. Fond memories, part of which, in addition to eating wonderful brown-edged cookies, was joining our grandmother as she watched the afternoon soap operas. The guiding light, search for tomorrow, as the world turns. Do you remember any others? The edge of night. Well, at the heart of all these dramas were endless tragedies, wicked living, sex, cheating, secrets, and any other sin available in 1956. Rarely was there any good news or joy lasting more than 5 minutes. They were all about, as Paul writes, idolatry, jealousy, anger, envy, carousing. By contrast, the Andy Griffith Show came along in 1960, sharing the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, Aunt B, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Pretty clear contrasts, pretty clear choices. However, we do not live on the set of The Edge of Night or in Mayberry, North Carolina. I find life a bit fuzzier than St. Paul. I don't see life or faith as either all bad, sinful, evil, or all good, kind, peaceful. Life is neither horrible nor perfect. We are humans. We are both creatures of the flesh and people of the Spirit. At this point, I looked at the reading from 1 Kings, where Elijah is sent by God to anoint kings over Israel and to choose Elisha as a prophet of God in Elijah's place. Elisha is someone chosen by God who, like many, say, yes, but I will follow you, but first I've got to go clean out the refrigerator. But first let me get things in order. And Elijah sends Elisha back to his plow. And we don't know what happens there, but I think Elijah realizes he really needs to follow God's call. And he does. He takes that chance. Fast forward to the Gospel from Luke. All along the way to Jerusalem, people come up to Jesus and say, "I will follow you, I will follow you." And when Jesus says, "Come on, follow me," they echo Elisha's response, "Yes, but first." To which Jesus says, "No. No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." This business of following Jesus is not easy. It is good, it is right, but it is not easy. Guided by the Spirit, we are to look forward to the kingdom, to a better world, to a new creation. The famous civil rights and gospel song came into my head. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. So of course I Googled it. Where else do you look for anything? As you may know, that was a variation on the song, Keep Your Hand on the Plow, Hold On, based on this reading from Luke. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. It was a spiritual song both in black and white churches. But what I learned was the history behind the change in the lyrics to keeping one's eyes on the prize. In the 1940s, a woman named Alice Wine was part of a group on Johns Island in South Carolina who were seeking adult literacy classes to teach African Americans to read and write so that they could register to vote. They contacted Guy Carawan at the Highlander Center in Newmarket, 20 miles down the road here. And classes started on John's Island at night, hiding in a store for protection. And by 1958, 600 residents of the island had passed the incredibly difficult state's literacy test. It was called the Citizenship Program. And it kept its hand on the plow and its eye on the prize of freedom. Alice Wine was the woman who taught Guy Carawan the refrain, keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. I know this seems somewhat convoluted, even to me, but what I love in reading the scriptures and doing my best to be guided by the Holy Spirit, all sorts of amazing connections open up, from soap operas to civil rights. Alice Wine, who wanted to read in order to be allowed to vote. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. May our arms be open to others. May our gifts be revealed to us so that we may return that which has been given.